Hi, good morning, everybody. Thanks for being here. I suppose I need to find the clicker. Does that work? Great. Okay. So I'm really excited to be here. I think that it's no secret the evolution, the advancement, and certainly the progression that we've made in digital over the last 7 years is quite something, and certainly spectacular. So I'm excited, Integral's excited to be, you know, really at the forefront of this change. And you know, one of the things that was sort of most resonating to me, and if you let me indulge you for a little bit, started on Saturday morning when I was actually doing some work to this presentation. My six-year-old and nine-year-old came downstairs for breakfast. And they said to me, Dad, what are you working on? So my nine-year-old, who seemed to be a little bit more inquisitive than my six-year-old, I explained to her, I was working on this presentation that I was giving today. And she said to me, well, what's this presentation about? And I thought, you know, okay, well, this is gonna be a one-line answer, and then she's gonna worry about cereal and eggs for breakfast. And she said to me, you know, what is this about? I said, well, it's about how people advertise more effectively online. You know, when you look at your iPad or you look at the computer screen and you see these ads, it's really understanding how that makes a difference to consumers. What do you mean? So I kind of gave her the, well, it was my opportunity to be a good dad and explain to her what I do at work, but I gave her the sort of viewability 101 primer. And it ended off with a discussion saying, look, you know, basically, if an ad has an opportunity of being seen, it's called viewable. If an ad has no opportunity of being seen, it's called unviewable. And I think she got it, at least I thought so. And at that point, my six-year-old says, Dad, are you nervous? I say, yeah, I'm very nervous. I said, well, what makes you most nervous? I said, what makes me most nervous is that nobody is gonna show up. And so I thought, okay, we're done now. Time to move on to cereal. And at that point, my nine-year-old turned around and said, does that make your presentation unviewable? So I'm really, really happy that somebody showed up so I can go home today and tell my six-year-old and nine-year-old that my presentation was actually viewable. But more importantly, even a nine-year-old understands the opportunity of seeing things. So, you know, as mentioned, I'm from Integral, and Integral is an analytics technology that really helps to foster more effective communication between buyers and sellers in the digital space to ultimately drive advertising performance. And great, now what does that mean? So in order to discuss where we think we should go, let's take a step back. Long, long time ago, when this amazing device permeated American living rooms, obviously it was called the television, and this was a wonderful thing, right? It brought families closer together. Every night or every week, people would sit around the sofa and watch their favorite programming. The experience was much more immersive. There was volume, there was animation, there was motion. And this was significantly better from a media consumption perspective than anything that they had seen before. Like all good media and all good advertisers, there was an opportunity. And so with the rise of television viewership, with the rise of TVs being placed in people's homes, what we saw was this rise of TV advertising. And don't get me wrong, you know, we still see today TV commanding the lion's share of advertising or marketing budgets. But really, as advertisers started spending more and more online and asking more questions about how well was this medium working for me, what was performing, measurement started being introduced. And that measurement wasn't any less sophisticated than what we see today. It wasn't any less different or ineffective, but it really focused on taking certain variables into account that were pretty specific to TV. And what are some of those variables? Well, for starters, and our marketing partner had a great time with these old TV sets, so we were trying to use a flat screen, but I think this is a lot more character. Firstly, it was highly regulated content. Most of the time, an advertiser has a very good perspective about what show they're placing their ad in, what the nature of that show is, and quite frankly, which other advertisers are going to be advertising next to them. Secondly, the ad takes up the entire screen. There's no TV set that displays the ad in a half screen, at least not many. Thirdly, it's a consistent format. Advertisers know that the ad will be delivered in a certain way, and for the most part, that format stays the same. They don't have to worry about switching formats between different TV sets. Most of the ads run for a fixed period of time, 15-second slots, 30-second slots. And lastly, and probably one of the most important, is there's only one screen. I don't know about anybody in this room, but I haven't been to a friend's house where they've got three TV screens lined up next to each other. Sports bars maybe, but certainly not the majority of American households. So when they developed measurement and they took into account all these various different media factors to produce a calculation that essentially determined performance, it was very specific for this medium. And now, if we kind of translate that to digital, which in our minds has become, you know, probably one of the most, if not the de facto media consumption channel today, we've got a whole host of different media-related things to consider when we think about measurement. For starters, most of the content's not regulated. There's tons of social media, there's tons of user-generated content, there's blog posts, and obviously there is content that is professionally produced. But in many cases, advertisers have a limited amount of control as to where their ads are being placed. More importantly, we've got multiple ads on the screen. I don't think it's going to come as a surprise to anybody here that there are sometimes 2, 3, 5, 10, and in really bad cases, 20 ads on a page. Even if all of those ads are in view or have the opportunity of being in view, what we're seeing is that each of those ads that are in view are taking up a share of view or a percentage of the user's attention. And that's something that we don't have a lot of these days, is attention. We, as an industry, have introduced a number of different formats. We've got display, we've got video, we've got mobile ads, we've got native ads, we've got ads on OTT devices. All of these different types of formats present different types of problems to advertisers. Maybe not problems, but challenges in how to determine what's effective. And finally, we've got a lot of different screens. Not only do we have phones and iPads and desktops and digital TVs, but what we also have is different applications. I've never seen somebody pop open Word or Excel on their television screen in front of the ad that is airing between a in a commercial break of a television program. So when we think about measurements online and we think about what really drives advertising performance, we have to take these variables into account. And the variables, as we see it from an integral perspective, really exist mostly in how the media is consumed differently. And that is an important thing to consider when you try and figure out performance. Oh, I forgot, we've also got fraud in digital, which is, I know the last topic we talked about a little bit, but obviously fraud is another big factor that determines whether or not we are we're effective. So, is it all terrible? Is it all bad news? Is it all frustrating and confusing and lack of transparency? Well, no, that's the good news, is we have made a lot of progress. When we started the company back in 2009, one of the biggest initiatives that this industry started focusing on was media quality. And it started with things that were identified as casting a dark shadow over digital. And it started with things that we could, you know, relatively, with the right technology, control. And so things like brand safety have largely been a focus of the industry for the last 5 years. We're seeing fewer and fewer people focus on brand safety issues. Viewability, we've moved from an impression-based currency to a viewable currency. No longer are advertisers accepting ads that have never got an opportunity to be seen as acceptable. And finally, despite the continued attempts of the bad guys to circumvent the digital properties and commit fraud, we are seeing reductions in fraud levels. This is all great news for the industry. This is all positive direction and continued momentum. But at the end of the day, does this really solve the problem that advertisers are trying to ask, which is, did I drive incremental lift? What kind of change in behavior did I enforce through this ad campaign? How can I create a return on investment model that identifies incremental or additive lift? And so we try to answer this question for our advertisers. We try to really focus on a couple of key things. But most importantly, what we wanted to do was figure out a way in which to establish true ROI. Now, there's a lot of discussion about attribution in the market right now, and we see this as something quite different. In our minds, attribution is a way to divvy up payments to determine who ultimately gets paid for their performance on the campaign. Return on investment is something that is much more causally driven and much more related to the fact that caused the change in behavior or the purchase that the advertiser is trying to achieve. So through one of our products called Causal Impact, we essentially simulated for the duration of campaigns in an automated way, A/B testing, to ultimately figure out what type of media exposure was driving conversion. And we found a few really interesting things. Firstly, we found that media quality has a direct impact on causal performance. Surprise, surprise, I'm sure everybody in this room will be totally shocked at what I'm about to say, but ads that are out of view, ads that are served to non-humans, and ads that are served on websites which are extremely cluttered or have multiple ads on the page and there's a lot of confusion for the user to identify that media message, do not perform as effectively. So the steps we've taken over the last 7 years are actually positive steps to improve the advertising experience and to improve performance for advertisers. The next two were something that we found really interesting, and I'm gonna spend a little bit of time talking about them, but they were directly related to how many times a user is exposed to an ad and how long that user is exposed to an ad. And so looking at some data and breaking it apart for the first round of the explanation, what we did was is we looked at exposure frequency, the number of times somebody was exposed to an ad, and the related incremental lift of that exposure. And so obviously, it sounds quite, you know, obvious. Okay, well, the more times you expose somebody, likely the higher amount of conversions you're gonna get. And that's true to some degree, right? But if you look at the shaded part of the slide, at eight impressions or eight viewable impressions, we started to see a decline in performance as measured by true return on investment. So we took a step back and said, okay, let's compare duration. And let's take a look at the amount of time that somebody was exposed to an ad and what happens there. And we saw a very similar effect, that obviously the longer you expose somebody to an ad, the higher likelihood was that the ad would perform for them, causally. But at between 50 and 60 seconds of total exposure time to a particular user, we started seeing a tail. We really didn't know why that was. So we started looking at both of these things in conjunction. And we started playing with different types of exposure and frequency analyses. On the leftmost chart, on the y-axis we're showing incremental lift, the same as in the other charts. And the x-axis we're showing frequency, number of exposures. For viewable impressions between 0 and 2 seconds exposure, we saw a marginal additive lift. It performed, but it didn't perform as well as we expected it to perform. We increased the exposure to between 15 and 20 seconds and kept the impression frequency at 8. And what we found was, there was a substantially bigger additive lift. But when we married the two points that we found on the last two slides, the optimum number of exposures before we saw the decline in performance, and the optimum number of frequency before we saw a decline in performance, what we saw was a dramatic tail off in terms of the ROI. And the reason for this could be a number of factors. One, it could be that the user had a negative association towards the brand and decided to, you know, move away from the product in terms of buying something or brand recall. It could be that that person was never actually going to buy your product in the first place, so this campaign had no real effect on them. But the point that we've discovered and the message here is that the total amount of time you expose somebody and the number of times you expose them has a sweet spot. And the sweet spot is something that we as an industry should all be trying to achieve. So why can't we do this today? You know, what's the challenge that we're faced with today? And, I'm sorry, this is actually relatively important. So when we measured the campaign, so we had a look at how the campaign was performing from a causal conversion perspective, but then we actually looked at what was the distribution of viewable impressions and frequency of viewable impressions to users. And what we found was startling. What we found was that 82% of users were served less than two ads, viewable ads. So, you know, I read somewhere that, you know, back in the 1930s or 40s, there was this notion that you serve at least seven ads to somebody before you can create some sort of a change in behavior. Whether that holds true or not, we came in at around 8 exposures for optimum. So if you extend your eyes out to that 8 number on the right, you're seeing that less than 0.5% of the users were actually exposed to 8 viewable ads. Now, that's quite alarming, and that at least in our minds is a concern that we should address as an industry. When we looked at duration, what we found was that about 50% of the users were actually exposed for less than 2 seconds. If you extend our eyes out again to sort of the 50 to 100 second duration bucket, it was less than 2 users. So when we think about how we're exposing our audience, how we're targeting our consumers, what we're doing is, in reality, dramatically under-indexing in this particular use case. We're certainly seeing areas where we're over-indexing on some of the other advertising studies that we did, but for the most part, we are seeing a dramatic underexposure of people in the digital channels to drive optimal performance. And so why do we see this? Why is this something that we find pretty common? And we tested probably about 25 to 30 big brand advertisers with this method. And the reality is we've got some flawed and mixed assumptions when we talk about how we measure performance and how we actually account for things like viewable impressions and exposure. For starters, we are randomly setting frequency caps. There is some analysis behind how we arrive at what a frequency might be, but it's very often done at a publisher by publisher level and not at a user level, and it's even more difficult to try and do it at a campaign level. Challenge here is that we're also taking into account that every single impression served is actually seen or has the opportunity of being seen. That's a bit of a stretch because we are seeing a lot of our customers and partners now remove viewability or unviewed ads from the equation. So we'll take those unviewed ads out. And the reality still becomes that we treat every single one of these viewable impressions as equal. So what about the ad that was seen for 15 seconds? Versus the ad that was seen for 3 seconds, or the ad that was seen for 1 second. Should each of those exposures to a particular group of users or user itself be treated as equal? And we believe firmly that the answer is no. We believe that the total exposure that is put in front of the user, mixed with the number of times you expose that person, is the key to driving optimal results with regards to targeting. So where does that leave us? So firstly, as I mentioned, we need to continue to apply rigor. We need to continue to apply energy to the things that are causing decay. When I go out and I speak to brands and I say, hey, why do you buy a TV? They tell me, hey, because it works. Okay, I'm not gonna argue, they are my customers. I say, why don't you spend more money on digital? And they say, well, because it doesn't work. Well, why doesn't it work? Well, primarily because I don't trust it. I don't know what I'm getting. There's no transparency. And well, quite frankly, I don't know how to measure for performance. So I throw a bunch of money at it in the hope that something happens. And that's probably a little bit of an exaggeration, but that is a general trend or gist of conversation that I have with brands. So we need to continue to make sure that as an industry, we clean up our act. No more porn, no more hate speech, no more fraud, no more ads buried in the bottom of websites that never have an opportunity of being seen. And so that will continue, and we believe that will always be a challenge that we fight, and as we get that under control, it will become essentially table stakes. We need to start shifting our thinking from attribution or correlation-based performance models to causal-based performance models. And it's refreshing because when I do have some conversations with brands, with agencies, with publishers and platforms, there is definitely impetus behind this and a trend towards it. Everybody is doing a lot of really great work to focus on how we actually improve real performance, how we understand which campaigns are driving the most incremental lift. But there's more, and this is essentially the kind of key takeaway from this, and our marketing department always insists on a takeaway, so I'm gonna give it to you here, and hopefully they will be okay with the way I deliver it. But the reality is that we need to stop thinking about viewability at an impression level. We need to stop thinking about 700,000 out of 1 million impressions were viewable. We need to start thinking about the total exposure that a user has to a particular ad and the number of times that they've been exposed to enable that optimum performance. That might be different for CPG campaigns versus telecom campaigns. It might be different if you're looking at an entire brand versus at a subset of brands. But the reality is that the technology to do this, the data that's available, and the platforms that we have in our ecosystem allow us to action on it. And so I certainly look forward to a day where advertising in digital is less about how many people or how many impressions I can spray out there, but far more calculated in terms of what are the right impressions to put in front of people to drive performance for what we ultimately do here is improve the quality of advertising. And so I have about 3 seconds left, and so I will say thank you very much for your time. And I hope this has been interesting and useful. We are around for some time today, so if there are any follow-up questions or conversations that you want to have, please feel free to reach out to us.